Hello, my beautiful friends, and welcome back to the Trace Keikis channel. I am Chantel, and this video is about reviewing popular natural eczema treatments. Perhaps you've heard of these ingredients and are wondering if they really work. I'll touch on the trending ones and of course give my pointed opinion. Before we start, I feel compelled to say that as a pharmacist, I'm completely advocate for the use of pharmaceutical interventions with eczema, especially for severe eczema flares. However, I'm very concerned for my patients that reach for steroids constantly. It's not going to turn out well for them. Chronic steroid uses have some pretty nasty consequences. Not only will you have photosensitivity and develop thinning skin, it can also lead to papules and pustules and even more flares. I've made it my mission to help people avoid flare-ups by providing education and alternative treatments that will help reduce the need for chronic steroid use, especially in children who absorb more steroids in their body than adults do, which makes them more prone to side effects with long-term consequences. So let's dive into some current natural ingredients that you can use to help avoid flares and reduce the need to use steroids. On the top of my list is colloidal oatmeal. It's the most common ingredient found in eczema therapy creams. And for good reason. I cannot say enough good things about using colloidal oatmeal. This plant-made grain targets multiple causes of eczema, all at once with no harmful side effects. Not one. First of all, how is colloidal oatmeal different than the stuff we eat for breakfast? Well, it's really not. Both start using the grain of oat plants. For the stuff we eat, the grain is rolled, which means it's smushed, packed, and shipped. The colloidal process of oatmeal is finely ground in giant industrial blenders and put into lotions or creams or just sold as is, mixed right into the bathwater. That's as farm to skin as you can get. Our skin loves colloidal oatmeal because it contains the right types of fats as well as vitamins and minerals that soothe the skin and has the added bonus of keeping our skin's good bacteria healthy. In other words, it helps out our microbiome. The microbiome of the skin surface is a term used to describe the bacteria, yeasts, and molds that normally live on the surface of the skin. Believe it or not, this little community plays an important role in our skin's health. If the microbiome gets out of whack, that alone can contribute to a flare. Just as I said earlier, it turns out oatmeal is good food for our skin's little microbial guests. There's a few studies that show that the good bacteria on our skin, Staphylococcus epidermis, thrives on oatmeal. On the other hand, the same study has shown that the bad bacteria, Staphylococcus aureus, doesn't really like to eat oatmeal. And because of this advantage for the good bacteria, oatmeal helps keep the skin's microbiome on the healthy side. That's what these studies concluded. But the really good part about oatmeal is its plant power anti-inflammatory effects. There is a plant molecule found in oat grains that has been shown to reduce inflammation in the skin by blocking the release of chemicals called cytokines, which are the cause of inflammation in the first place. In addition to oatmeal's anti-inflammatory effects, oatmeal also binds large amounts of water molecules and keeps them close to the skin, thus making oatmeal a great tool at hydrating the skin barrier, which we know is key for all eczema patients. Oatmeal is quite the multitasker. I love colloidal oatmeal. It's a natural no-brainer in eczema treatment. Next up in our natural treatment review is zinc oxide. Zinc oxide is considered an essential mineral. It's essential, meaning we must have it for our body to function, and we cannot make it ourselves. Humans need to eat food rich in minerals to absorb zinc. Zinc deficiencies lead to some pretty nasty diseases, but that's mostly focusing on internal medicine. How about external medicine on the skin? For centuries, zinc oxide has been used for wound healing. Today, zinc oxide is a typical ingredient found in most diaper rash treatments. It's commonly used in anti-dandruff shampoos and sunscreens. While we know that zinc is useful for healing wounds and open flares, did you know that zinc oxide is also a helpful tool to maintain a healthy skin barrier and prevent eczema flares? There have been multiple studies that show that creams and ointments containing zinc display impressive anti-inflammatory effects that, again, are useful during a flare. But when it comes to flare prevention, zinc is still a useful mineral to have around. Usually, zinc-containing ointments are too thick or too uncomfortable to apply all over in a moisturizing routine. However, recently I've noticed more lighter moisturizing lotions formulated for eczema still have small amounts of zinc included. And that is because newer studies have shown that even low concentrations, less than 1%, have positive effects on the skin barrier. Think of it as topical zinc supplementation. Our skin cells use zinc in their chemical reactions to make collagen, and it's an essential compound used in the process that breaks down fats and inserts them into the skin barrier. even a slight deficiency in zinc can affect the skin barrier. There was even one kind of funny study done in 2013 that had people sleeping in zinc-infused pajamas to see if it would help prevent eczema flares. While the study was mostly subjective, the patients did show improvement on many measurable factors, including a better night's sleep from less itching disruptions. Sleep in zinc. I'd recommend giving zinc a try. You never know, it might just be the mineral you've been missing. This next natural treatment was a little more tricky for me to wrap my head around. People are using hypochlorous acid on their skin. That's a scary name, right? Lately, I've noticed more advertising for this peculiar natural compound being marketed for eczema flare treatment and prevention. How on earth, with a name like hypochlorous acid, can this be a good natural ingredient? And for eczema? Well, hypochlorous acid is actually nature's oldest disinfectant. It's even something that our body makes to, well, kill bacteria and fight off infections. The chemical made in our body supplies the workhorses of our immune system, the white blood cells, with a weapon to break down the biofilm around bacteria and viruses, thus producing cellular death. Pretty cool, huh? Hypochlorous acid is a natural compound made from salt and water. That's it. However, in the body and in the laboratory, a little work needs to be done. Electricity is applied to the mixture and the molecules rearrange. They swap partners and become hypochlorous acid and sodium hydroxide. Pretty cool little chemistry trick. Hypochlorous acid is as effective as bleach at killing germs, and it's found in everything from toothpaste to drain cleaner, which means concentration matters. It can be very harmful to the skin. Remember, just because our body makes it doesn't mean that it's safe for everything. For example, did you know that the stomach makes hydrochloric acid strong enough to burn through metal? Just because your stomach can handle it doesn't mean that the rest of you can. So keeping that comparison in mind with hypochlorous acid and our skin, I was a little skeptical. How would this natural disinfectant help with eczema treatment? There are several companies out there selling diluted sprays of hypochlorous acid intended to mist on the skin. One company's marketing slogan is, 70% of all eczema is bacterial. Now, I'm not so sure that this claim presents the facts in the most truthful light, but technically it's true. 70% of patients with an eczema flare will develop a bacterial infection at some point. I assume their position is kill the bacteria on the skin, solve the eczema problem. Science knows that this doesn't work in eczema patients as a method of prevention because antibacterial baths and soaps tend to induce more flares rather than preventing them because it's killing all the bacteria, not just the bad ones. Just like we talked about with the colloidal oatmeal, the skin's balance of good bacteria and bad bacteria of the whole microbiome is crucially important for the health of our skin barrier. My main concern with this bacterial killing spray would be it's killing the good bacteria that could disrupt the microbiome. So of course, I turned to the studies to see what science and medicine had to say about this spray option. After a lot of reading, it seems science does have a lot of favorable evidence that topical spray of hypochlorous acid is safe and effective for the treatment during an eczema flare. It's not only a great natural antibiotic and antifungal, it also helps prevent itching, interrupting the cellular signals that the skin is using to tell the brain to itch. That's a pretty cool function of this molecule. However, with that said, my original hunch was correct. I wouldn't recommend using this every day to prevent flares. Because it is so effective at killing bacteria, it can disrupt a normal, healthy microbiome. If you're not experiencing a flare, don't mess with your microbiome by killing off all the surface bacteria. Remember, we actually need those guys. On the other hand, if you have an area of skin that's constantly getting flares, it's very possible the microbiome in that area is out of balance and overpopulated with bacteria or fungus, making it ripe for infection. In this case, I would recommend trying it as more of a spot treatment to help restore the balance. It's definitely a natural tool to keep in mind, especially if you use this to prevent a flare from becoming a nasty bacterial infection, which we all know will lead to the use of antibiotics and then contribute to antibiotic resistance. The less often you resort to antibiotics and steroids, the better for you. For a quick review, we've talked about colloidal oatmeal as a must for eczema prevention, and we've talked that there is some evidence that zinc oxide can work too. It turns out that hypochlorous acid is a surprising helpful ingredient to reach for when a flare is forming. Let's turn to our next natural treatment. When I was preparing for this video, I noticed a popular herb, St. John's wort, was trending in new eczema products. Perhaps the trend was from some new marketing, or has there been new discoveries in St. John's wort? Last time I checked, it wasn't for the skin. St. John's wort's been used in teas and supplements for many years, probably thousands of years. It has strong evidence of treating depression and postmenopausal symptoms. It's actually a pretty powerful herb. So when I first saw these new products, I was pretty doubtful. So I did what I do best. I set out to learn from the available science and see what supports these new claims. With an open mind, of course. Most of these studies I came across were small and they were not well designed. A lot of the studies were just a set of surveys sent home with people asking them questions about their symptoms. That's pretty subjective and not very trustworthy. But then I ran across a small study that put a lot of thought into their design, and the results were pretty promising. They conducted a randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled format, which we know is the gold standard form of studies. But unfortunately for the researchers, they only managed to enroll 21 patients who had mild to moderate symptoms. So not a very big sample size. The results were pretty good though, enough so that I think it's worth mentioning this study. By the end of this study, both patient groups had improvement, most likely because of their new efforts of daily moisturizing. These patients probably weren't as diligent about daily moisturizing before they became study participants. And because they were all now moisturizing daily, even the placebo group had improved symptoms. Score for good habits, moisturize daily. Even better though, the group that had the St. John's wort added to their moisturizer improved their skin barrier even more than the placebo group, with a strong statistical p-value of less than 0.5. I bring up the statistics value because in such a small group, achieving that statistical number means the improvement had to be significant over the placebo. The smaller the group, the more difficult it is to get statistical significance. With such a well-designed study that had statistical significance, I would feel confident that St. John's wort did have something to do with the added improvement. The theory for this improvement is because St. John's wort has an active molecule called hypericum. This molecule embeds itself into the skin barrier, where here, hypericum exerts its anti-inflammatory powers and helps promote the health of keratinocytes, our main skin cell in the barrier. Hypericum does double duty when calming the immune system and supporting healthy cells. Another surprising measurement the study took was to measure the colonization of Staphylococcus aureus. Remember, the bad skin bacteria found on everybody's skin. I'm happy they took a look at the skin's microbiome because that's often an overlooked component of eczema flares. In this study, it turns out that the bad bacteria was reduced in both groups as well. This result should be expected because researchers already know this phenomenon is a result of daily moisturizing. There's many theories of why this happens, but what you need to know is daily moisturizing helps keep your microbiome in check. Even though both groups had less of the bad bacteria, the group with the St. John's wort added to their moisturizer had even less than the other group. But that result wasn't as statistically strong as it should be to get too excited about, even though I am. So, should you use St. John's wort? Well, this was a small trial, and even though the trends were good, I wouldn't go out of my way to find a product with it in it. But if you already have a product that you like and has this plant power in it, go ahead. It shouldn't hurt, and it's very plausible it will help. Last up, black tea and tannins. Tannins are a group of molecules that several types of plants make. They're found in witch hazel, pine, eucalyptus, oak bark, and black tea. Note, tannins are also what humans have used for centuries to turn fresh cowhide into leather. So will it make you leathery? I love formulating with alcohol-free witch hazel, and I often consume black tea. So I couldn't help but be intrigued by an article reviewing how black tea facials can help with eczema. In one study, a group of researchers brewed non-flavored black tea and soaked gauzes in them. They applied the tea-soaked gauzes to people's faces that were experiencing facial eczema flares. They did this 5 times a day for 6 days. What they found was statistically rapid reduction in all 4 measurements that they used to track the progress of eczema healing. Even after 3 days, there was a big difference. Maybe I'll hold on to my tea bags in case I need a facial. Tannins have been studied for their anti-inflammatory effects for quite some time now. They're thought to exert their healing powers similar to the actions of topical steroids. However, the main difference is that tannic acid does not suppress the growth of our skin cells, keratinocytes, like steroids do, but instead it helps keep them healthy. This is a huge advantage over topical steroids and a win for plant power molecules. So now that we're coming to the end of this video, I have to put in a shameless plug for a plant power and one of my other videos. Licorice and its terpene glycyrrhiza is finally getting the recognition it deserves for treating eczema. There's even a prescription lotion with this plant star, and its main active ingredient is glycyrrhizin. This is because plants do it better. You should check out that video next. It's pretty cool what licorice can do for eczema treatment. In short, licorice works to calm the immune system down, nearly as good as the leading 1% topical steroid cream. I go much more in depth in the video of the powerful effects of licorice and why I think it's better than steroids. Click on the link below and check it out. There are many things you can do for your skin to prevent a flare from occurring. The less you reach for steroids and antibiotics, the more useful they'll be for you when you really need them. Okay, bye for now.